السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولقد آتينا موسى الهدى وأورثنا بني إسرائيل الكتاب هدى وذكر لأولي الألباب. فاصبر إن وعد الله حق واستغفر لذنبك وسبح بحمد ربك بالعشي والإبكار. إن الذين يجادلون في آيات الله بغير سلطان أتاهم إن في صدورهم إلا كبر ما هم ببالغيه فاستعذ بالله إنه هو السميع البصير. لخلق السماوات والأرض أكبر من خلق الناس ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعلمون. وما يستوي الأعمى والبصير والذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات ولا المسيء قليلا ما يتذكرون. إن الساعة لآتية لا ريب فيها ولكن أكثر الناس لا يؤمنون. وقال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخرين. الله الذي جعل لكم الليل لتسكنوا فيه والنهار مبصرا إن الله لذو فضل على الناس ولكن أكثر الناس لا يشكرون. ذلكم الله ربكم خالق كل شيء لا إله إلا هو فأنى توفكون. كذلك يوفك الذين كانوا بآيات الله يجحدون. الله الذي جعل لكم الأرض قرارا والسماء بناء وصوركم فأحسن صوركم ورزقكم من الطيبات. ذلكم الله ربكم فتبارك الله رب العالمين. هو الحي لا إله إلا هو فادعوه مخلصين له الدين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. قل إني نهيت أن أعبد الذين تدعون من دون الله لما جاءني البينات من ربي وأمرت أن أسلم لرب العالمين. هو الذي خلقكم من تراب ثم من نطفة ثم من علقة ثم يخرجكم طفلا ثم لتبلغوا أشدكم ثم لتكونوا شيوخا. ومنكم من يتوفى من قبل ولتبلغوا أجلا مسمى ولعلكم تعقلون. هو الذي يحيي ويميت فإذا قضى أمرا فإنما يقول له كن فيكون. صدق الله العظيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا، وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك أستغيث، أصلح لي شأني كله ولا تكلني إلى نفسي طرفة عين. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما، وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما مباركا ميمونا، ولا تجعل فينا ولا منا ولا معنا شقيا ولا محروما. القرآن كلام الله. The Quran is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the virtue of his speech is always returned back to who spoke it. Firstly, do we understand English? I don't know Danish, I don't understand. So I'm really sorry. Either we have two options. We have Arabic and we have English. So if you want Arabic, raise your hands. No, not really. Okay, English? Okay, خلاص. English. So the Quran is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَفَضْلُ كَلَامِ اللَّهِ عَلَى سَائِرِ الْكَلَامِ كَفَضْلِ اللَّهِ عَلَى خَلْقِهِ. The virtue of the speech of Allah over all other types of speeches, it is like the virtue of Allah above his creation. Can you compare Allah with his creation? Can you? You can't, right? Because you cannot compare Allah with his creation, the speech of Allah as well cannot be compared with the speech of creation. Now, for example, if a young child walked into this room, a young child, young boy or young girl, and they said, I have a car. I have a car. This is kalam. It's called speech. What have you understood from this kalam? Have you understood that they have a Mercedes or they have a Toyota or they have a different car? Or did you understand that it is a car that they play with? You've understood that it is a car that they play with. It's a toy, right? But the child didn't say it's a toy. The child said, I have a car. This is for us. Why did you say it's a toy? لِأَنَّ you looked at who spoke it. It's a child. This child cannot drive a car. So because a child cannot drive a car, the child must be talking about a toy. So this kalam, you have taken it and you looked at who said it and you place it on the level of that person. Makes sense, right? If somebody who has a lot of money, somebody who's very wealthy, millionaire or billionaire, they say, I have a car. It's not going to be like your car. It's going to be better than your one. It's going to be an amazing car. It's going to be a special car. It's going to be a very valuable car. But they didn't say this. But you have understood from this person that this is who they are. So their speech is based on who they are. الكلام قيمته قيمة قائله. Any type of speech, its قيمة and virtue is who said it. So if we've understood this now, what is the قيمة of كلام رب العالمين? The virtue of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he spoke to all of the prophets in the Quran, he always tells them his virtue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he spoke to Isa. وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمَ اذْكُرْ نِعْمَتِي عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَى وَالِدَتِكَ إِذْ أَيَّتُكَ بِرُوحِ الْقُدُسِ تُكَلِّمُ النَّاسَ فِي الْمَهْدِ وَكَهْلًا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said to Isa alayhi salam, Oh Isa, you and your mother remember my virtues upon you. Allah is telling him to remember. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he spoke to Musa, وَلَقَدْ مَنَنَّا عَلَيْكَ مَرَّةً أُخْرَى. We have given you virtues, O Musa, more than once. This is the second time we have made your brother Harun a prophet just like you. Every single prophet, when Allah speaks to them, he reminds them of his virtues upon them. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Rasuluna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبَعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ لا تمدن عينيك إلى ما متعنا به أزواجا منهم ولا تحزن عليهم واخفض جناحك للمؤمنين. We have given you the seven often repeated verses, Surah Al-Fatiha. And we have given you the Quran Al-Azim.
قيل, it was said, القرآن العظيم, it means فاتحة as well. We have given you the Surah Al-Fatiha, and we have given you the rest of the Quran as well. This is what we have given you, O Muhammad. This is your hadiyah from Allah. This is your gift from Allah. This is your blessing from Allah. So remember the blessing of Allah upon you. Allah is protecting this Quran for you and I, not for anybody else. When you hear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preserving the Quran, you look at it from a legislative perspective and you look at it from a spiritual perspective. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't protect the Quran for you from the time of Muhammad, you are not living at the time of Muhammad. You are going to come a lot after. So you would never come into contact with this Quran. So because Allah jalla wa ala wanted you to come into contact with this Quran, He preserved it for you until you came into existence. So you can see this Quran and you can come into contact with this Quran. You can read this Quran, memorize this Quran, understand this Quran, live by this Quran, and enter into the Jannah of Allah, Rabbul Alameen. Because of this Quran. Isn't this a ni'mah? Say Alhamdulillah. This is for you and I. This is for the brothers and this is also for the sisters. I am looking this way a lot because I'm lowering my gaze. Don't think the sisters are not looking at you. Just to clarify. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us as a ummah. This Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He described it to be nur. That means if you don't have Quran, you don't have nur. You don't have light. This Quran is nur. Ya ayyuhan nas, O man. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بُرْهَانٌ مِّنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ نُورًا مُّبِينًا. Indeed, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a burhan has come. Burhan, an evidence has come, a proof has come, a witness has come. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ, and we have revealed upon you نُورًا مُّبِينًا. We have revealed upon you a clear light. This is your light in your life in the dunya. This is your light for your life in the akhirah. This is your light that will guide you to Jannatul Firdaus. This is your light in this world so you can be happy. And you can be content and you can be happy in your house and happy outside of your house, at work and outside of work, with your friends and when you're with other people. Every type of life that you find yourself in, this Quran can be a light and a nur for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions the opposite in the Quran. The one who doesn't have the Quran is going to be in a difficult life, a dark life. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions that this Quran came down to take people out of darkness and into light. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام را كتاب أنزلناه إليك لتخرج الناس من الظلمات إلى النور بإذن ربهم إلى صراط العزيز الحميد. A book that we have sent down upon you, O Muhammad. It takes people out of darkness and it brings them into light. It takes people out of darkness and it brings them into light. Sometimes the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, the Nabi, in the authentic reports, he would meet some of the kuffar of the Quraysh or some of the kuffar that resided in Al-Madinah, and he would read the Quran upon them, and he would not give them a tafsir or a bayan or a reminder or a muhadara or a lecture or a khutbah or a sermon. He would read the Quran upon them and they would come into Islam. They will say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka rasulullah. We testify that Allah is the only one worthy of being worshipped, and we testify that you, Muhammad, you are the messenger of Allah. By just reading the Quran. From some of the reports that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He calls the Prophet ﷺ to be a reason for people to come into Islam, is his recitation of the beginning verses of Surah Az-Zukhruf. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Hameen, Wal Kitabil Mubeen, Inna Ja'alnahu Qur'anan Arabiyan La'allakum Ta'qilun, Wa Innahu Fi Ummil Kitabi Ladayna La'aliyun Hakeem. أَفَنَضْرِبُ عَنْكُمُ الذِّكْرَ صَفْحًا أَنْ كُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا مُسْرِفِينَ وَكَمْ أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ نَبِيٍّ فِي الْأَوَّلِينَ وَمَا يَأْتِيهِمْ مِنْ نَبِيٍّ إِلَّا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَهْزِئُونَ فَأَهْلَكْنَا أَشَدَّ مِنْهُمْ بَطَشًا وَمَضَى مَثَلُ الْأَوَّلِينَ ولئن سألتهم من خلق السماوات والأرض ليقولن خلقهن العزيز العليم الذي جعل لكم الأرض مهدا وجعل لكم فيها سبلا لعلكم تهتدون والذي نزل من السماء ماء بقدر فأنشرنا به بلدة ميتا كذلك تخرجون والذي خلق الأزواج كلها وجعل لكم من الفلك والأنعام ما تركبون لتستووا على ظهوره ثم تذكروا نعمة ربكم إذا استويتم عليه
وتقول سبحان الذي سخر لنا هذا وما كنا له مقرنين وإنا إلى ربنا لمنقلبون.
That's it. Did I give you the meaning, the tafsir now? They didn't get the tafsir or the meaning either. They listened to it. And my voice is ta'ban. But the Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام, his voice is very beautiful. They listened, they looked down. When he finished, they looked up. They said, we are now Muslimin. By listening to the Quran. That's it. So you yourself, a ta'thir, a good impact can happen in your life if you listen to the Quran. But you listen to the Quran how? You listen to the Quran with a heart that is awake. Not a heart that is ghafil. And some of us, we are listening right now to the muhadara, we are listening very carefully. But some people may not be listening. Some people, they may be on WhatsApp or Instagram or Facebook or TikTok. This is not good. Delete TikTok, by the way. The other ones, keep it if you want. But TikTok is very bad. I don't even have TikTok. In my whole life, I never had it. TikTok is dangerous. That's a different lecture for another time, inshallah. Let's not switch the topic. But people are maybe sitting and they're not focusing right now. But if you are focusing with the Quran al-Kareem and you are listening attentively, then it will enter into your heart, inshallah. So this is the secret. What is the secret? What is the miftah? What is the sirr? The sirr is that you have to be listening attentively. The second secret is, when you are listening to the Quran, you need to be looking for fawaid and benefits. The Quran is filled with fawaid, but you need to be looking for it. Does the Quran have benefit? Yes. But you need to be looking for it. If you think the Quran has no benefit for you, and the benefit is outside of the Quran, the benefit is in the dunya, the benefit is in money and cash and Quran and all of this, then you will not receive the benefit of the Quran. But if you want to receive the benefit of the Quran, you approach the Quran with a niyyah sadiqah. I was telling the brothers in another lecture yesterday, there was a man in Al-Madinah, an old man. This old man, he couldn't read the Quran. He could only listen to the Quran. So what would he do? He's in the masjid of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Anytime somebody comes in and he's reading Quran, he goes to this person, he says, I can't read Quran. Can you read Quran and can I listen to you? So they say, yes, no problem. One time someone came in, he said, can I listen to you read the Quran? That man, he said, yes, no problem. So he listened to him read the Quran. The qari, the one that was reading, he reached an ayah that has sujood tilawa. He went to sujood. So this man who was listening, he went to sujood as well. When the qari finished sujood, he came up, and this man, he died and he went to the akhirah. He passed away, rahimahullah ta'ala. Now look, he passed away in sujood, number one. He passed away listening to Quran, number two. He passed away in the masjid of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam in Medina, number three. Is this husnul khatima or not? Is it a good ending or not? It's a good ending. How do you know if somebody is going to have a good ending? It is the way you live your life. And Imam Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, من عاش على شيء مات عليه ومن مات على شيء بعث فيه. The one who lives by something, he will die by that thing. Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyya, from the scholars of the past, he mentions a lot of people, when they were passing away, and their family was saying to them, say la ilaha illallah, say la ilaha illallah, say the statement, it's a key to Jannah, say la ilaha illallah. They said, checkmate, checkmate, checkmate. When they're playing the game, checkmate. Because his whole life was games. Now imagine you are passing away and your family are around you and your mother and your father and your wife and your husband and your children and your loved ones, and they are witnessing this horrible reality that this is coming out of you and you're not saying La ilaha illallah. There were some people in Al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, he mentions, from the men, when they were passing away, they said to him, say La ilaha illallah, and he's saying the name of women. And the same thing for women. There were some women, they told La ilaha illallah, they're saying the name of men. So this is considered to be su'ul khatima, a bad khatima. La ilaha illallah, it will put you into Jannah. Other than that, you will not be able to enter. So this man, he passed away like this, reading the Quran, لِأَنَّ his life was all about Quran. The majority of the people who are here, whether you are female or whether you are male, as far as I can see, there are some uncles and aunties, but the majority are young people. So because we are all young, then the young person is in ever so much need of the Quran, more than everybody else. Every Muslim is in need. But the young man and the young lady is in more need. Because you want Allah to take care of all of your affairs. You want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you a good spouse, a good husband, a good wife, good children, good wealth, good house, good life, good everything, right? Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمْ. Indeed, this Quran, it guides to everything which is upright. Everything which is upright, في الدنيا وفي الآخرة. Not just آخرة. دنيا and آخرة. دنيا and دين. If you want everything to be okay for you, go to the Quran, inshaAllah ta'ala. Some of us, the shaytan comes to us and says, I'm old now, I'm 20, I'm 25, I'm 30, I'm 20. I'm like this, I'm too old, I can't do it. I lost my chance to go duksi and madrasa and tahfil and maktab, whichever language you are from. I lost my chance. Who said you lost your chance? So long as you are still breathing and you have an opportunity and you are living, you have a chance. Until you pass away, you have a chance. Every single person has a chance. There's no discrimination. Nobody has been told that if you become 20 or 25, is it a hadith or something? Is it ayah of Quran? You become 25, normal Quran? No. This is in our minds. The shaitan put it in our minds. We have to take it out. We have to remove it from our minds. And remember that if you want to protect yourself from the shaitan, then the best way to protect yourself from the shaitan, it is attijah or al-ittijah ila al-Quran al-Kareem. It is for you to head to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the shaitan, he does not like the Quran. He doesn't like it. He said in the Quran, لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ سِرَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. I'm going to be in the path, in their way, the path of Allah. I'm not going to allow them to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you have Quran, Quran is greater than the shaitan and the iblis and all of the jinn and all of the afarit and all of the bad things. The shaitan is greater. The Quran is greater, afwan. So because the Quran is greater, then the Quran will protect you from all of those sins. So my message today is very short. I do not wish to make it a long reminder. I wanted to just remind myself and our brothers and sisters who are here of the importance of this book that Allah sent down to us. He sent it down for you and I. So it is important that we make sure that we are in one of three groups. You must be in one of three groups. There's no fourth group, whether you are male or female. The first group are those who memorize the Quran. Those who memorize Quran, the ulama, they say they have a portion of nubuwwah. You have part of prophethood. Are you a prophet? No, you are not. The last prophet was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But what Allah gave the prophets, which is wahi, is with you. Some of the ulama, they say, if you know one juz of Quran, you have one juz of nubuwwah. If you know two juz of Quran, you know two juz of nubuwwah. If you know the whole Quran, you have all of nubuwwah, because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave to our prophet. So you memorize the Quran, فَتَكُونُ وَتُصْبِحُ مِنْ خَيْرِ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ. You are going to become from the best and the greatest of this ummah. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. The best from amongst you are those who learn the Quran and teach the Quran to other people. This is the first group. So you try your best to be from amongst them. The second group, they are those who are working to be from the first. So they're learning the Quran now. You're learning, you are going to tahfidh, you are going to the sheikh, you are reading Quran, you are memorizing Quran, you are understanding Quran, and wallahi, I'll tell you something, if you are going to try. Are you going to try, brothers? Put your hand up if you're going to try. But how are you going to try? You didn't hear what I have to say. Well, it's too hard. If you go and you start a journey of Quran to read to a sheikh in Denmark or Aarhus here, and you go to the masjid and you learn the Quran in the masjid, when you come out of work, you go home, you get dressed, you take your mushaf, you go to Baytullah, the house of Allah, the masjid, you sit down on the side and you read Quran for 1 hour, wallahi al-azim, there is no feeling like it at all. Nothing is like it. If you read Quran in your car or your house, there's no feeling like it as well. But when you read Kitabullah fi baytillah, there is nothing like it at all. If you try this, it's going to become an addiction. Every day you're going to go. So that's why I want you to try it. Because if you try it the first time, you will never stop. So try your best to learn the Quran and read the Quran in the masajid, in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the second group are those who are learning the Quran. If you are an adult male or an adult female, you try your best to learn the Quran with ma'na, with meaning. There's some people who are maybe struggling with certain elements of religion. They are struggling maybe with prayer. Maybe they are struggling, some of the brothers, to grow a beard, to keep to the sunnah. Maybe if it's a sister, maybe they're struggling with hijab, for example. All of these things, everybody has different struggles, right? We can try to understand each other's struggles. But when you have Quran in your life, it's like Allah is consoling me. Allah is advising me. It makes sense to me now. Sometimes when people advise us, we feel like a bit harsh or kind of. When Allah is telling you, you feel happy. SubhanAllah. I remember, this is a true story. There's a sister in London. She's married and she's a mother. She has children with her husband. And her husband called me. I don't know why they called me, but they called me. They called me and they said, we want some advice from you. What is the advice? The wife, she doesn't wear hijab. And she said, I read the Quran. I didn't see anywhere where hijab is obligated. She's saying this. And she's saying, some of my family are saying, wear hijab. And some of my family are saying, don't wear hijab. So she said, I'm stuck. I don't know what to do. So she's asking me for advice. I think it was last year this time, or maybe the year before this time. It was in the winter. So I said to her, number one, as for there's no obligation of hijab in the Quran, this is incorrect. The obligation of hijab in the Quran is there. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ وَبَنَاتِكَ وَنِسَاءِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ. The obligation of hijab is in the Quran. Maybe you missed it, I said to her. As for this part, I just said to her one thing. I said, now we're in the winter time. Maybe get a scarf like this, a scarf, and maybe just put it over your head a little bit and a bit around your neck. And you need it anyway because it's cold, right? Do this, cover a little bit. It's not official hijab. It's unofficial hijab. But I said, just cover your head a little bit. It's cold, you need it. She said, okay, I can do that. That's easy. Wallahi. She said, I started that. And she said, this is good. I like this. This is nice. It's easy. So now she started to wear a khimar. Then she started to wear a hijab. Now she wears a complete jilbab all the way down. If you say to the person, do this or don't do this, nar, jannah, like this, this is a harsh way. Fihi ghilla. Some people, this doesn't work. You have to take a path that the person can relate with. All I said to this sister was, it is now winter, you need to wear a scarf, just put it on your hair, you have covered it, unofficial hijab, and inshallah you will come to official hijab. She came to official hijab by herself. Another brother, that's a story for sisters, a story for a brother. There was one brother, he came to Islam. He was non-Muslim before. Do you know how he came to Islam? Not because of Arkan al-Islam or Arkan al-Iman. He came to Islam because someone said to him, you know, a lion has a mane, it's called in English, mane, like the beard. He said, the lion without the mane, what is it? Lioness, it's a lady. So he said, in Islam, you have to have a beard to show that you are a man. He said, khalas, I am a man, I'm coming to Islam. That's for the brothers. Yes, it's just da'wah. Is that how you have to understand how to give the message? If you know how to give the message very well, then the person will come to Islam very quickly. But if you don't know how to give it very well, it will take some time. So this is inshallah ta'ala what I wish to give. And inshallah ta'ala, I actually want to come back inshallah ta'ala to this city specifically and do some seminars. This is a lecture. But do some seminars where we are spiritually pumped and we understand the reality of practicing our religion and we find beautiful ways for it to suit us inshallah ta'ala. It should suit us anyway, but I think we have a bit of a barrier or we have a bridge that we need to bring back inshallah ta'ala. So I just wanted to come and give this reminder. I don't want to make it very long. I think there may be some questions as well. If there are any questions from the brothers, can you raise your hands? So I have an understanding. No? No questions? Okay, that's better for me. Any questions for the sisters? If you raise your hands? No? No? So no questions from anyone? Alhamdulillah. Okay, any questions again? Brothers, change your mind? No? Sisters, change your mind? Alhamdulillah, it's good. Allah. Sheikh Anas, khalas, we have more time or? We have more time, please. Okay. Finally, what I wanted to say to all of you, inshallah ta'ala, I didn't finish the three groups. Did I finish? Why did you not tell me? You meant to say, I have a question. You didn't finish the three groups. The first group was what? Those who have memorized Quran. The second group were those who are learning Quran. The third group, and then Nasir, subhanAllah. The third group are Ammatul Muslimin. Ammatul Muslimin, they're general Muslim. So they're not learning Quran, but they are just your everyday uncle or auntie, and they don't have time. These people, they need to read some Quran every day, and they need to listen to some Quran every day. So they're not doing tahfir, but they need to read something or they need to listen to something every single day. That means if you don't find yourself in one of those three groups, you have left the Quran and you are doing hujran of the Quran. You neglected the Quran. You deserted the Quran. إما أن تكون حافظا أو إما أن تكون دارسا أو إما أن تكون قارئا أو سامعا. You have to be either a person who has memorized it, a person who is striving to memorize it, or a person from the general folks and they listen to it and they read it as much as possible. And with that, you are not going to be a person who has neglected the Quran. So inshallah ta'ala, the message is that we need to try to be from one of those three people. Another message that I wanted to give is for the young people that we have in our families, young brothers and sisters, if you have your own children, sons, daughters, nieces, nephews, these people, we have to ensure that we give them good tarbiyah. Good tarbiyah. They look up to a lot of people that they shouldn't look up to. And they need to start looking up to the correct people, but it's about winning their hearts. Winning their hearts. The Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, he used to win the hearts of the Sahaba very easily. I'll give you some examples. And when you learn this art, and when you learn this passion of being able to do this type of da'wah, then the people will find you to be a lovable person. The Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu from the Sahaba, he came to him. He said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, who has the most right to your shafa'ah yawm al-qiyamah? That's a su'al. A su'al, a question needs an answer, right? The Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, look at his style. He doesn't just answer the question. He said, Abu Huraira, I always knew that you were going to ask me this question. He showed Abu Huraira that he's special. Then he answered his question. Then he's won his heart. Abu Huraira, I always knew that you were going to ask me this question. You're a special person. So now you ask me this question, this is the answer. This is an example with Abu Huraira. Another example is the Prophet ﷺ, he went to the battle of Tabuk. When he went to the battle of Tabuk, he looked at some of the Sahaba. There were 1,500 Sahaba there. He quickly scanned all the Sahaba, he scanned them, he looked very quickly, and he said, where's Ka'ab ibn Malik? From 1,500 people, he can't find one person. Now, if I look at all these people, I'm struggling to find one person, and it's not 1,500. 1,500 people, he showed that one person was missing. This shows that you have a qima in the mujtama'. You have a status in the society, and you are important. Now Ka'ab is going to say, the Messenger of Allah remembered me in front of 1,500 people. Yes, he remembered you. This is how the Prophet ﷺ was with da'wah. Another example is that the Prophet ﷺ, one time, he was with his grandchildren, Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn. Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn, they are the grandchildren of the Rasul ﷺ, the children of Ali and Fatima. So the Prophet ﷺ, one time he was moving on the floor with his hands and his feet, and Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn, they climbed his back and they rode on the back of the Prophet. So then what happened? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, or in another riwayah, it was another man, he came and he saw these children riding the Prophet's back. So he made a comment and he said, نِعْمَ الْمَطِيُّ مَطِيَّتُكُمَا. He said, the best riding beast that you are upon is this one, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he spoke and he said, وَنِعْمَ الرَّاكِبَانِهُمَا. And these two are the best passengers that ever went on a riding beast. They are small children. They don't even know what this means. But the Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam, he's preparing them. They are from Ahlul Bayt. They are from the household of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants for them to have khair in their life. So with your little children, if you play with them like this, when they go to nursery and when they go to reception, how do you say nursery again? You told me yesterday. Hasim, how do you say it? Sorry, you say it louder.
Burn in hell.
Burn in hell. Astaghfirullah. Ya Hasim. Sorry, it's my fault. Say it again. Burner?
Hawin.
Okay, that one, huh? You heard what I said. When they go to Burnie Hawin, this one, when they go there, why do they love to go to school? Think about it. When the children are young, 3 years old, 4 years old, 5 years old, 6 years old, do they love school or not? They love school. If you tell them, you are a father, you are a mother, you say, don't go to school today. They're going to cry, I have to go to school. When they get to 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, if you say, you have to go to school and say, I want to stay, I'm sick, I don't want to go. What happened when you were 5? You used to love going to school. Now you're 15, you don't want to go anymore? Because now they're 15, there's no more playing. There's homework, there's detention. You see, so what's happened here? When you're young, you're playing. They are nurturing you. They are making you love school, education. It's a system. When you're young, you have to start loving it. No homework yet. You're young, you play around, but you love school. Then later on when you come, you don't like it anymore. So similarly, the children, when they are young, we give them tarbiyah. We speak to them about the salah. We speak to them about the siyam. We speak to them about the Quran. We speak to them about all these khairat, but بطريقه التحبيب. We make them love it. The young girl, you don't say to her, وحجة. You say to her, you are a Muslimah. You have a lot of beauty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants khair for you. You are going to wear, you are going to show your hair in Jannah, not here. So because you are different from all of the other girls, and they are not Muslimat, they are kafirat, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make you different from them in the dunya and in the akhirah. Now she's going to wear the hijab. But if you say, wear the hijab, you have to wear the hijab. She will listen to you now because she's small, but tomorrow when she becomes older, she won't listen to you anymore. Because now she's an adult. Doesn't have to listen to you now. When I was young, he used to tell me to do this and this. Now I'm old. Khalas. And when the young boy as well, he's young, he'll listen to his dad. Because he's young. When he's old, khalas is a problem. But if you as the father, or you as the mother, or you as the brother, or you as the sister, as the uncle, as the auntie, if you have a relationship with these children, they're like your friends, they'll listen to whatever you say. Whatever you say, they'll listen. So this is another, inshallah ta'ala, reminder. It's very, very important. If we want to protect the next generation, we have, our generation is one, we have become older now, we have become the parents, and we have become the spouses, so let's look after the next one, inshallah ta'ala. The next generation, let us give a lot of importance to their upbringing and their tarbiyah, inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Let us make dua for one another, and let us make dua for all of the Muslimin around the world, and let us not forget anybody, inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala. When you make dua for others, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the angels, they will say, وَلَكَ مِثْلُهُ, and you will be granted the same. So if you make dua for your brother, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants him good children and a good wife and a good husband and a good house, then Allah will grant you the same, inshallah ta'ala. If you make dua for this person that they memorize Quran and they learn Quran, the angel will make dua that you learn Quran as well. Do not have hasad. It's another reminder. Hasad is something that has destroyed the ummah. Hasidin, kafir. There are a lot of people who have hasad and envy towards one another. If you find somebody to have a ni'mah and you like the ni'mah, you say Allahumma barik. Or you say barakallahu lahu. Or barakallahu laha if it's a woman. And that's it. If you are going to have a hasad towards this person, then you are not going to get that thing from this person, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect it for them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make things difficult for you, because now you have let the shaytan enter into your heart. What was the shaytan's biggest downfall? It was hasad. It was kibr. He was jealous of Adam alayhi salam. خلقتني من نار وخلقته من طين. So if you have hasad in your heart, you have a trait and a characteristic of the shaitan. That's it. Right or wrong? وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. When we told the angels to prostrate to Adam, فَسَجَدُوا, they all prostrated, إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ. Iblis said, no, I'm not going to prostrate. Aba, he refused. وَاسْتَكْبَرَ, and he was arrogant. وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, and he was from the disbelievers. في سورة صاد, Allah says, قَالَ يَا إِبْلِيسُ مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقَتُ بِيَدَيَّ أَسْتَكْبَرْتَ أَمْ كُنْتَ مِنَ الْعَالِينَ. قال أنا خير منه خلقتني من نار وخلقته من طين. يا إبليس, what's the matter with you? ما منعك? What has prevented you from prostrating to Adam? Why? He said, I'm not prostrating لأن خير منه. I am better than him. خلقتني من نار وخلقته من طين. You created me from fire and you created from clay. This is called hasad. Now a person will not say, the person will say, I come from a better house. My mother is better than your mother. Allahu Akbar. Who said that? Yani, you think your mother is better than her, this person's mother, and they think their mother is better than your. You will never hear the end of it. And my dad's better than your dad. No, my dad's better than your dad. No, my house is bigger than your house. This is what Allah says about the Quran. In the Quran, He says, "اعلموا أن من حياة الدنيا لعب وله وزينة وتفاخر بينكم وتكاثر في الأموال والأولاد تفاخر بينكم." You are all showing off in front of one another, and everyone is saying, "I have more family. I have more wealth." Do not do this. The Muslimun, they are one. The Prophet ﷺ, he said this. He said, مَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فِي تَوَادِّهِمْ وَتَرَاحُمِهِمْ وَتَعَاطُفِهِمْ مَثَلُ الْجَسَدِ الْوَاحِدِ إِذَا اشْتَكَى مِنْهُ عُضْوٌ تَدَاعَى لَهُ سَائِرُ الْجَسَدِ بِالسَّهَرِ وَالْحُمَّى. the example of the believers in their rahmah towards one another, in their love towards one another, in their care and compassion towards one another, is like that of one body. If part of the body is in pain, the rest of the body will not be able to sleep at night. This is how you have to be towards the Muslimin. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. Indeed, the believing males and the believing females, they are all brothers and sisters in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this. And we never ever refuse anything Allah gave to us. If Allah gave it to us, or if the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gave it to us, we take it and we accept it. And we enter into the religion of Islam completely. أُدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَّةً. Enter into the religion of Islam wholeheartedly. Don't pick and choose. I like this about Islam, I follow that. I don't really like that, I don't follow that. This is easy, this is love. Nah, you don't have a choice. أنت عبد. You are a servant of Allah. A servant says, I obey. He says, سَمِعْتُ وَأَطَعْتُ سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. He doesn't say, سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا. He doesn't say, I disobey. He obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the end of the day, you can only go into Jannah by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. يُدْخِلُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ فِي رَحْمَتِهِ. He puts into Jannah the one who he wishes through his mercy. So let us earn the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us inshaAllah ta'ala make that decision and take that step with the Qur'an inshaAllah ta'ala. Let us ensure that we give tarbiyah to the children bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Let us inshaAllah ta'ala clean our hearts from hasad and bughd and hate and all of these things that are not good for us inshaAllah. I wish the best for every single person who is here. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put every single brother and sister who is here tonight into the highest Jannah without punishment or trial, along with our families. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all for our sins. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you all and to make you happy in the dunya and in the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you all from the shaytan and the iblis and all forms of evil and harm. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all very good spouses and very good children and very good households inshaAllah ta'ala. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the dunya and the problems of the dunya. And until next time inshaAllah ta'ala, barakallahu feekum wa jazakumullahu khayran. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.